Great. So hello everyone. My name is Åsa. It's really great to be here. It's been an interesting day so far. So let's see this one, yes. So a little bit about me. I took my master's degree in engineering physics from Uppsala University back in 2006. And immediately after that, I worked for some time as a software developer for a company called Console Multiphysics. I worked with developing meshing algorithms in C++. After that, I was for quite some years a researcher in Ericsson Research, where I was mainly focused on how to improve monitoring and how to optimize mobile networks. And now, since about a year, I work in the analytics team at Truecaller, where we help the company apply a data-driven way of thinking and way of working on improving our product. So today I want to share an example story of how we work on doing that. So a little bit about Truecaller. This is a Swedish company that was founded in 2009. And we are currently about 80 employees. The headquarters is up on Kungsgatan here in Stockholm. And we also have a few smaller offices in San Francisco, in New Delhi, and in Bangalore. So the product that we build are mobile apps that aim to ease the life of smartphone users. So we focus a lot on improving the experience of your communication, mainly focusing right now on phone calls, making and receiving phone calls. So this slide basically shows some of the main features of our main app, which is called Truecaller, same as the company name. So on the left, you see an example of live caller ID, which is basically that when someone calls you, we will show you the name and additional information about this number, even if it's not in your own phone book. We also have a dialer built in, where you can search through the Truecaller's global phone book, an international phone book of numbers, for a number or a person that you want to call. And lastly, we have a feature which is spam identification and call blocking. So basically, the users of Truecaller all help each other to report unwanted spam or scam calls so that other users can be warned about these numbers if they happen to call them. So our products are available basically on all major platforms and app stores. We spend a lot of time on app localization so that all of our users can use the apps in their native language. We currently support over 40 languages. So when it comes to users, our apps have passed 250 million downloads worldwide. Our main market is in India, where about half of our user base is. And we are also big in the MENA region, in countries like Iraq and Turkey, Jordan. And we have some users in the sub-Saharan Africa region as well. This map shows basically some of our more established markets in blue and growing markets in red. We currently have more than 2 billion different phone numbers in our database, which is used to power the features of live caller ID and number search in our app. Currently, we detect about 500 million spam calls globally per month for our users. And our backend handles about 4 billion searches towards our server per month. And another additional 20 billion searches happen on the app, on the client itself per month. So in order to handle the storage and the processing of this never-ending increasing amount of data that comes in, we have our own private Hadoop cluster, where we run Cloudera 5. And this currently consists of 31 data nodes and 3 master nodes. You can see some statistics. So we have currently about 500 terabytes of disk space, and 2.8 terabyte of memory to the volumes, just like some fun stats. We're processing right now approximately 3 billion new events per day that come to our backend. And these are all events coming from all the installed apps on the clients out there, as well as from our backend services where we have logging about user searches and user authentication and such things that power our service. So in our cluster, we have a number of different tools installed to support us with our daily work. And I tried to just visualize some of them up here. For example, we use Falcon and OOSI currently for scheduling and data management tasks, but we're actually right now looking into changing maybe to Airflow, so that's also up there. We have all our major data sets stored in Hive, and we use Hue for interactive SQL queries and visualizations of some of that. And we also, yes, like most of our data pipelines are built using Spark. Some are built as Hive queries. It's like 50-50 almost. And then we have a few different notebooks actually installed, both Zeppelin and Jupyter, to do more of the interactive querying and plotting of data and so on, interactive data analysis. I feel like it's still going around here. Okay, should I continue? Wait. Yeah, I don't think it helps if I face it. Maybe that's not here. Okay, so coming back a little bit more to our product and what we offer our users. So when it comes to the product, one of the main things, as I mentioned, is spam identification and blocking. And this shows some statistics about spam calls around the world. So if you look at the top graph, this is data coming from our Truecaller users during August of this year. And it shows per country, so out of all the phone calls that our users receive that are unknown to them, that is they are not in their phone book already, how many of them are identified as spam. And as you can see, this is quite a high number. It varies quite a lot between the countries, but United States, as you can see, is in the top. There are actually 4 out of 10 calls that are unknown to the user is some kind of unwanted spam or scam call for that user. And you can see in India, which is our biggest market, the same number is 1 out of 4 calls. And if we instead look on a per user level, the bottom graph, it shows during a 2-week period, what is the percentage of users who have received at least one spam call during that time period. So in United States, again, it's in the top, it's 83% of users who during 2 weeks' time have received at least one of those unwanted calls. And as you can see, it's quite high for many countries. So spam call is really a big issue around the whole world, and it's actually growing as well. So we need to make sure that we can provide this kind of spam identification and protection to our users. And the straightforward solution to do this is that when you have the app installed and a number calls you, you can make a request towards our servers and we can provide you with an answer if this is a spam number or not. And that's also the main implementation in our product. But one additional challenge that we face is that our main markets are quite different from, for example, US and Europe when it comes to data connectivity. So in US or Europe, you would expect that a smartphone is connected to data in principle all the time. Like you would have Wi-Fi at home, you would have Wi-Fi at work, and maybe at a cafe, and in between you would be on the mobile network. But this is definitely not the case in India, for example, which is our main market. So as you can see on this graph, this shows the data connectivity that our users have at the time of making or receiving a phone call. And the blue and the orange bar corresponds to no connection at all, or at least too bad connection to make a search towards our servers. So So as you can see in US, this is a very small proportion of the calls, but in India, it's almost 60% of the time it's like that. So we need to still be able to provide a good spam identification experience for all these users, even when they are offline. So that's why we introduced offline spam call detection and blocking. So what is this? It's basically, we saw that we need to provide the users with a list of spam numbers that they can keep locally on the phone and that they can look up even when they are offline. So this has some more benefits other than providing more identification. It's also going to be faster identification for the user since the list is local and you don't have to look up. We're going to reduce the number of lookups towards our servers, which is going to be good for our server loads. And we can also enable some additional features on top of this. And we have in the app currently two different ways that the user can set to take action on these calls. Either you can like not do anything special about them, but you can also set the silent ring for these numbers in this list, or you can even let us auto-reject the numbers even before they ring. So that's a feature that I personally like a lot, so you don't even have to be bothered. What are the challenges with this? Well, as I mentioned, our main markets are not really the US and Europe. Our users have very limited storage space on their phones. They are more on the low-end devices. They also have data plans that are not good for downloading a lot of data to the phones. So we really want to keep this list as small as possible. So we need to compute the most relevant spam numbers for each user so that as many of the spam calls as possible get caught, but the list is still within some reasonable size. So some time ago we decided that we need to evaluate the current status of this top spammer list efficiency and look if we can do some changes to the algorithm to improve the performance. So this is basically going through how building those lists, those offline lists, worked. And to do that, we have as input a number of spam reports from our user base. It's currently around 470 million reports about numbers that users think are spam and numbers that users don't think are spam. You can compare it to like your email inbox where you can mark as spam or not spam. And then we also log, of course, all the identified spam calls to our users, which is about 500 million per month. And the algorithm basically goes through each reported spam number and gives it a score, which is based on a combination of the number of those reports, spam and not spam, that the number has gotten, and the recency of those spam reports, since we want to put more emphasis on newer reports. And also the country of the reporter of the number. So based on this, the algorithm then just sorts based on score and selects the top 2,000 spam numbers per country to be sent to users of each country. And these top spammer lists get updated daily and are implemented as a daily Spark job in our Hadoop cluster. We started by performing an initial evaluation of how efficient is the current algorithm in providing our users with spam identification. And efficiency in this case means that as many of the spam calls as possible should be found in this local spam filter list. That's good. So it should be 100% ideally. So as you can see in this initial evaluation, there are some countries where this efficiency is almost 100%, like Nigeria, Jordan, Kenya. So that's very good. This means that we almost never have to make a server search. But then in some other countries, it's not that great. So India and US is both below 70%, actually. So our main concern with this was that India is so low. It's also our main market. And it's a market where we have a lot of problems with spam calls. So we asked ourselves if we can do anything that's better than this. And we had some ideas that probably some countries are just too large or diverse in some way to be efficiently covered by 2,000 numbers. And some people also thought that spammers probably act on a more regional basis. Like a spammer in Delhi would not necessarily be calling someone in Maharashtra, we're talking about India. And we also thought that we can probably extract the region of the user from the phone number that they use based on prefix matching. So all in all, we thought that more relevant spam filter lists could be computed if we take into account also the more detailed region of the user. And we thought also that we can map each user to a region. So, but before we went off and did the implementation of this whole thing, the analytics team was requested to make like an initial evaluation of what would this really mean in terms of efficiency. So we decided to first do a very quick initial check, where we basically went through a few weeks of calls in India, spam calls in India, and tested this hypothesis if it's really regional spam calls or not. So we went through all the calls, looked at the user's phone number, looked at the spammer phone number, and mapped them both to a region according to a prefix matching. And then we checked how many spam calls come from within the region, how many spam calls come from within the same country, in this case India, and how many spam calls come from outside of the country. And this is the result we had for the top regions or states of India. So as you can see, it's quite a large proportion actually that comes from within the region. So it kind of gave us a first confirmation that this hypothesis can be correct. We still didn't know how much of an impact would this have on the actual efficiency. So that was the next step when we saw these results. So we did a more detailed investigation where we basically wanted to simulate, let's say, on historic data, what would have been the efficiency if we would have taken another approach to building this list. So we went through data from the first week of February 2016 that contained of 22 million spam calls in India. And we implemented a Spark job that created several top spammer lists per country based on mapping each user to a region instead of only the country. So I'm skipping through some details here, but what we found in the end was that we were expecting to see 28% efficiency improvement in India on that first graph that I showed you. So this was really like good results and motivated change in implementation. So the next thing was to bring this to our backend team to really put it into product implementation. So they needed to update the existing Spark job to consider this regionality of true core users. So it required adding some logic to map each user's phone number to a region and some implementation details about that. I don't know if people went to the Spark course or workshop, but we use a broadcast variable for sending this prefix map, since it needs to be mapped on each and every single row, on each executor. And currently this job is running on 12 executors, with six executor cores each, 16 gig memory and 16 gig driver memory. And it takes 22 minutes of execution time, and this runs daily basis. So the new top spammer lists were released on 18th of March this year, and immediately after that, we of course tracked what was the change in reality, and we saw that immediately after launch, the improvement we saw in India was around 20%. We also saw an improvement in the US, which went from I think 67 to about 75%. And then there were, of course, some countries where not much happened, like Nigeria and Egypt in this case, which had already quite high efficiency to start with, so we didn't see any change there. We also didn't see any change for a country like Sweden, where it's not really true that you can map a region from a mobile phone number here. So then the whole algorithm doesn't make much sense. So we didn't see any change there either. But if we convert from percentages to actual numbers, this change meant 50 million more spam calls that get blocked immediately per month. So just to conclude, I would just like to point to a few things that are maybe known to everyone in this room, but still are important. So first of all, when you're a data scientist trying to work on product improvements, it's really important that you have good quality data, that you have detailed data that you can trust to work from. So that's why our team spends a lot of time defining exactly the event tracking that should go on the phones and quality checking those so that we know that we can rely on this data once we have it. And the second point is that in order to know if and where your product needs improvement and what can be done to improve it, it's very useful if you can use your historic data and kind of simulate changes on top of that, so that you don't have to implement everything into production before you can actually test it. But that also comes back to the first point, that you need to be able to trust your data and you need to have detailed enough data to make such experiments. And lastly, I believe that for a lot of products, you can actually make substantial improvements by just looking a bit closer at your data and trying to come up with new and smarter ways to use it in the product. So that was all. Thanks for listening.